Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film, Valentine's Day Edition. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. As Elise mentioned, we've got a Valentine special subject for you. Marnie by Alfred Hitchcock and La Captive by Chantal Akerman. And stay tuned once those discussions are done. We've got a fairly related Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto at the TIFF Lightbox. We saw Douglas Sirk's Written on the Wind, so we'll be having a brief discussion of that one as well. Before we close, well, let's talk first about your decision to pair these two films for a special subject on Valentine's Day, Elise.
Well, the flow is good too, as they say, or they used to say, I don't know if this is fully up to date, retail marketing, the flow, right, between episodes, because we had a couple of romantic obsession or sexual or erotic obsession last episode.
Fox 1945.
Yeah. We've talked about both of these films, Marnie and La Captive, briefly before. La Captive, when we did the whole Akerman retrospective, TIFF retrospective, commented on all of the films.
Those were just little snippets of conversation here and there in 2019.
Yeah, that's right. Didn't we choose to focus on particular films and then mention others in passing?
That's right.
Marnie, we saw in the theater fairly recently.
Yeah, we saw that at the Paradise last year, I think.
Was it the Paradise?
Yeah, it was definitely the Paradise.
Marnie, like Written on the Wind, is a film I know like the back of my hand. I've seen it so often. Both of them I first watched in my early 20s, and back then I was not doing a film podcast and not going to a Cinémathèque. Less was available to watch, so I did find myself watching certain films that appealed to me in a particular way many times, which is not something, we were just chatting about this today off mic, not something we do as much anymore.
No, there's no time, sadly. But I also grew up watching and rewatching many films. You know, I've seen The Roaring Twenties, for instance, 30 or 40 times for sure.
Why did I pair these two movies? Well, I wanted to do Marnie for the podcast because it was at one point a favorite film of mine, and La Captive I just wanted to see again. I wanted to see any Akerman again, and this seemed like a way to do it with this film. Connection is obvious between them. Both films involve a man who has in some sense captured a woman that he's obsessed with. As Akerman said in the video interview that we watched, La Captive is not a romantic film, and neither is Marnie, but they are both films that definitely interrogate what love is. So I thought that was fitting for Valentine's Day. So you're not as familiar with Marnie as I am.
No, I watched all of the 30s and 40s and even into the 50s Hitchcocks, but I tended to do a one and done on the others. Everything from Psycho onward, I just kind of didn't interest myself in those all that much. I've come to love Marnie under your tutelage.
After your one viewing. So Marnie is a film that I took to, I would say, somewhat perversely in my early 20s when I was self-styled aesthete who was resistant to certain reductive forms of feminist criticism, which I've since become confident enough to fully embrace, you know, for whatever they're worth. For, you know, in some cases the analysis is limited, but I'm not going to pretend that the way I read film is not informed by feminist film criticism. Of course it is, hugely. Might not always be my favorite prose, but unlike Repulsion, Polanski's Repulsion, which I absolutely loved and took to my heart the first time I saw it without knowing anything about Polanski, only to be told immediately after watching it that he was a rapist, and that really messed with my head, but I still love the movie. Marnie had a poor reputation in Hitchcock's oeuvre, but there had been some revisionist criticism around that, starting with Robin Wood. So, as someone who was very infatuated with The Master, but mostly with the period of films that you were less enthusiastic about, late 50s and to mid 60s, although I know, of course, you are enthusiastic about Vertigo.
Oh yeah, Vertigo is where I usually stopped. I was not interested very much in North by Northwest or anything after that, let's say.
Yeah, I love all of those, but particularly particularly Psycho and Marnie.
Well, out of all of those now, I would definitely say Marnie is my favorite. I like it much more than Psycho.
You haven't revisited the others under my tutelage, though.
Well, we've seen Psycho together, and I think it's a good movie, but I'm not that into it.
That's true. I forgot about that viewing at TIFF that had some pretty bad feminist criticism attached to it.
In the introductory speaker, yeah.
That's right. So in addition to there being controversy over the style of the film, whether it was good Hitchcock or not, there's a lot of controversy over the rape scene.
It's startling.
Well, let's talk about the production history. Well, this is a great way to start our Valentine's Day episode talking about the rape scene in Marnie, but here we go.
Well, yeah.
Let's get into it. So in my not so humble opinion, as somebody who's watched a lot of mid to late Hitchcock, Hollywood Hitchcock, and done a little bit of reading, very little bit of reading about the man himself, you don't have to go far in reading about the man himself or watching his films before you encounter his rape fetish. He is a man who, as permissiveness increased toward the end of the 50s and early 60s, was determined to get a rape on the screen, did it metaphorically quite a few times, you know, with Psycho shower scene and the birds attack on Tippi Hedren, then did it politely in this movie, and then later did it not so politely in Frenzy.
Yeah, Frenzy is a movie I really don't ever want to see again.
And no one of all of the film dudes I've hung out with, oh, sorry to put you under that rubric, of all the cinephiles I've hung out with, everyone has told me, just don't watch it. Like, if you love Hitchcock, just don't watch it. There's no way to salvage it. There's nothing to be gained by watching it. So the first screenwriter, well, not the first screenwriter, but the first main screenwriter to be attached to the project was Evan Hunter, who'd written the screenplay for The Birds. He wouldn't write the rape scene. Or rather, he did write it, but he was really pressuring Hitchcock not to do it. He thought it was out of character for the character of Mark as they developed him. Although it was in the novel by Winston Graham.
Does the novel have any kind of a reputation?
It's been adapted into a stage play and into an opera.
Okay.
But I don't know whether it has any reputation or whether that has to do with the movie bringing attention to it. I don't know. It's not a literary novel. You know, Winston Graham was a popular fiction author. So Hunter was pretty traumatized by this experience of conflict with Hitchcock over the rape, and this is how he said it went. Hitch held up his hands the way directors do when they're framing a shot. Palms out, fingers together, thumbs extended and touching to form a perfect square. Moving his hands toward my face like a camera coming in for a close shot, he said, "Evan, when he sticks it in her, I want that camera right on her face."
Wow.
And if you've read even the tiniest little bit about Hitchcock, you believe that he said something more or less like that. He was famously vulgar and sexual in the way he spoke to his collaborators and liked to shock, is how he described this to Evan Hunter, which would have made me leave the project too. Although I think Hunter was fired, but you know, after a lot of mutual conflict. Is that how he filmed it? No. Her face is involved, but not in the way that is being described here.
No, not really. And then it cuts to a nice view of the placid ocean out the portal.
Sort of. I mean, we'll talk about the scene when we get there. He then replaced Hunter with J. Preston Allen, a female screenwriter. This was her big break as a writer. She later went on to have hits as a playwright. The way she described this assignment, well, here also Wikipedia entry. His replacement, J. Preston Allen, later told him that, "You just got bothered by the scene that was his reason for making the movie. You just wrote your ticket back to New York." I don't know if that's a quote from Hunter again. Yeah, that's another quote from Hunter. So again, who knows how exact this quote is, but if J. Preston Allen thought that this scene was Hitchcock's reason for making the movie, or if even it was just Evan Hunter who thought that, they were probably right for the reasons I described. So let's just be adults about this. Because I have heard people who love this movie, men, film writers, defend both the scene in the movie and defend Hitchcock's intentions. But the art is wiser than the artist. There's absolutely no reason to defend Alfred Hitchcock as a human being and pretend that he had any kind of noble, conscious motives, or even anything other than the worst conscious and unconscious motives in making a movie around this scene.
Okay, but let's try to think about this. The way the narrative unfolds, you have to see it as in dialogue with a long tradition in film and popular literature of marital rape as somehow being exactly what the wife wants, the woman in question.
Yeah, but on the contrary, this movie is to some degree an intervention in that.
That's exactly what I'm saying. It's speaking to that. It's saying, no, he does this. It cuts to this ocean. You might be thinking, oh, that's what she needed all along. But then she immediately tries to kill herself. That's the way the film progresses.
And it's a very measured kind of suicide attempt, which I've always found interesting. Like, I think the idea you're supposed to take away is that she hated it so much that she wanted to kill herself, but she's not crazy and she wants to live, so she kind of hedged her bets a little bit. But she was serious enough to kill herself.
Yeah, she leaves the door open for him to pull her out of there.
Or somebody to. Yeah.
Yeah. She didn't jump in the ocean. She said she didn't want to be fish food, but as you say, it may also be because
there's a will to live.
Yeah.
And that's an interesting intervention, too. Rape, she hated it a whole lot, but rape, not a fate worse than death.
No, there's no way to defend Mark's actions. He didn't help her in any way here. He made her life even worse, and the movie is clear on that.
Yeah, but it also presents you with a male protagonist who is a rapist and nevertheless is very sympathetic and ends up being the person who helps her the most in the movie. Some of that, I mean, it seems that that's all roughly true of the novel as well, but some of that is the result, as Hitchcock said, of screenwriting compression, because in the movie she sees a psychiatrist, and he thought that was better, that was more realistic, but, you know, they didn't have the extra hour to send Marnie to a psychiatrist.
He'd already done enough of that in Spellbound.
Because of that, because we have this sympathetic rapist protagonist whose rape is nonetheless portrayed as wrong.
A brutal transgression.
A very bad, bad mistake and violation. The movie becomes very, very complicated. What part of Hitchcock's brain was he using when he shaped the screenplay with the screenwriter and filmed what he filmed and directed the actors as he did? Not the same part of his brain that described what he wanted to do to Evan Hunter.
Well, that's true.
He undersold himself.
Yeah, of course, because this movie is genius. Does things that no other Hitchcock movie really does.
Grace Kelly was Hitchcock's first choice for this role when he began developing it in 1961, but she was already Princess of Monaco. Certainly not in a role like this, but everybody wanted to play this part, and after doing The Birds with Tippi Hedren, he decided on her. And nothing that she does in The Birds, let alone the fact that she had been a model with no acting training, nothing that she does in The Birds would prepare anybody to think that she could handle this role. You know, this is like Oscar bait territory, yeah. Right? And part of the reason the movie failed with critics at the time was seeing Sean Connery and Tippi Hedren in these roles, and nobody thought that they came up to snuff as performers. That combined, I'm sure, with Hitchcock's very unusual stylistic choices in this movie, unusual for himself and unusual for any movie at the time, the expressionistic acting and visual flourishes, right?
I think they're both incredible in this movie. It's got to be the best role of Sean Connery's life, I think.
Grace Kelly can be a good actress, but can you imagine... Well, first of all, can you imagine her playing this role at all? But secondly, can you imagine her going for it the way that Tippi Hedren does here? You know, practically in Cheryl Lee, Fire Walk With Me territory? I would compare what she's doing here with the one-off performance of Robert Stack in Written on the Wind, which is also stylistically insane. Like, questionable as technical acting, but has this core of fucking method truth and pain, right? That is just one of the all-time, both of them, just all-time great cinematic performances.
Yeah, I can see the affinities there. I mean, Robert Stack was a more experienced actor, certainly. He'd been in movies since the 30s by then.
Yeah, but he never really did anything like this.
No, he was usually a straight arrow type.
Yeah, Sirk was pushing him into places that few actors have gone. And he went there. He went there all the way. So do you want to start from the beginning with this movie? We start with a businessman who's been robbed, named Strutt, played by
Martin Gable, a frequent guest panelist on What's My Line. He was married to Arlene Francis, who is a regular.
You're the one who usually identifies character actors, people in small parts that appear in different movies that we've watched. But Marnie I know so well that I have, on several occasions, identified somebody from Marnie when we're watching, like, a TV, a Star Trek episode, or, what's my line? That's Strut!
Sure, well, Marriott Hartley, Zara Beth from the second-to-last Star Trek episode, the last good Star Trek episode. She's also in Peyton Place. We also got George Anderson from Peyton Place, and Kimberly Beck from Peyton Place, the little girl that Marnie is feuding with. She was the witness in Peyton Place who had such a huge role.
And somewhere in something, and I can't remember what it is now, we also identified the sarcastic secretary from this first scene.
Oh, right, yeah.
But anyway, we have this businessman, this middle-aged, portly businessman, Strut, who's been robbed. And he describes the young female employee who robbed him to the police. And another attractive young secretary is standing by, kind of rolling her eyes. And the cops are sniggering because it's obvious from the way he's describing this woman that he hired her without any references because he had the hots for her. He kind of got what he deserved here. Oh, Mr. Strut, don't you remember? She didn't have any references. No references at all. Right from the first scene, the movie is clearly on the side of these victimized women.
We keep cutting to the Marnie cam as she walks on various train platforms with her stolen loot. She's got a tried and true method with a bag or a purse that she switches with a purse or a bag that is present in the office. She changes the color of her hair and her purse with every escapade.
Sure, and this purse of secrets that we get a big close-up on, it's the first thing we see of her.
Mm-hmm.
And then we see a mysterious woman with black hair walking away from us. Mysterious, elegant woman. You know, the purse is her metaphorical vagina of secrets. Well, it's her Pandora's box full of identities.
That comes right out of the Blithedale romance with Priscilla and her silk purses that you can't find your way into.
And of course she keeps her identities behind her mirror as well, her compact mirror. Now she's switching back into her real identity. I think this is the first time I ever consciously noticed you can't wash black dye out of your hair and emerge a blonde.
You have to peroxide it back.
But it works so well because, you know, it's like she's washing all of this falseness and all of this vile grime of Strut out of her, right? And then her true light identity emerges from this and she looks so free and happy. Also because she's had this quasi-sexual thrill of getting the money from him.
Went into the safe and walked out with it. She was always working overtime. Her integrity was never questioned until all of a sudden she's gone.
And then she goes to complete her sexual thrill by riding on her favorite horse, Forio, at some stables where she keeps him.
This is the real Marnie. That's what the film gives us to understand. It's really the only time where she seems happy in any way. Then she goes to visit her mom.
Right, that's not happy.
No, but she's in her real identity there as well, but it's so stunted and warped. She shows up at the door. It's opened by a young girl, Kimberly Beck. Marnie immediately goes into war mode with this little girl.
Right, and Tippi Hedren is being asked, turns out to have the exact right qualities for this, is being asked at various points to basically play a little girl. She has been stunted in this way, right? And she can revert to that persona at any time. She was, you know, traumatized at that age, and she's frozen there a little bit.
Oh, it's you again, Jessie.
And this kid is giving back just as good as she's getting.
Yeah, well, she's obviously had a few run-ins with Marnie, and she's not inclined to be charitable.
So this kid, blatantly obvious in the screenplay, has replaced Marnie for her mother. For some reason, she cannot directly show love to Marnie and never has been able to, but she, and it has something to do, as we eventually learn, it has something to do with the circumstances of Marnie's birth and her being a single mother and how that forced her into prostitution, and all of this just has gotten in the way of the love that she does feel for her daughter but cannot in any way directly express.
No.
Instead, she likes tormenting her with this little girl and rubbing this relationship in her face.
Yeah, I guess it's hard to know how conscious that
is. It's completely conscious.
I mean, this relationship's going on all the time, whether Marnie is around or not.
She reprimands Marnie for getting jealous of Jessie, and she looks kind of smug when she's doing it.
Yeah, she does. She does. There's a lot going on there. Clearly, the mother resents Marnie in a way for jet-setting around with these bank presidents or whoever she's supposed to be an assistant to. She does suspect something quote-unquote indecent is going on there, even though she denies that later. There's a weird game of cat and mouse going on between mother and daughter.
On the one hand, Marnie absolutely does not want her mother to think that she is sexually immoral or active in any way, but on the other hand, she does seem to be enjoying bringing up that possibility to kind of torture her with, too.
Well, she doesn't like the way her mom keeps bringing in Bible Belt talk. She's got no reverence for those outmoded moral codes, that's for sure. But she's got her own moral code that is even stricter. I mean, she really is a virgin, I think. That's what you gotta think. I mean, she's more, and she says that at the end, I'm more decent than you ever imagined.
Yes, and her mother is very proud of that.
So you created a monster, Mom.
Something very messed up is going on here. I've always wanted to write an essay on Hitchcock's use of sound in this period, particularly in The Birds, and I was noticing it more in Marnie on this viewing. The post-dubbed sound in both of the movies, totally unnatural, unrealistic sound, gives this hypnotic, I mean, it's not in every scene, it's certainly not in the last scene, but in many of these scenes, these are, you know, kind of classic melodrama written scenes, like this scene in the kitchen between Marnie and her mother that builds up to a slap, right? Classic melodrama scene. But the hypnotic calm of the actors' post-dubbed voices and the strangely offbeat editing that Hitchcock is using in this movie, offbeat editing, offbeat cuts, shots, things cutting too fast or holding on too long, and the actors staring at each other in silence, it is absolutely surreal. And the dialogue, too, takes a surreal turn after the slap when suddenly they're talking about calling Jesse over to pick up the pecans, which makes absolutely no sense.
It is her pie, after all.
Yeah. So, on the one hand, yeah, it's a classic melodrama scene, but on the other hand, it's completely surreal in the way it's filmed and performed and even written. Mark, we've already been introduced to Sean Connery's character.
Well, he's there at the investigation scene during the first robbery. He is an important client of Strett, and he joins in the general merriment at this man's discomfiture. He remembers Marnie.
Well, he's reminded of her in that moment. So he, at that moment, connects that pretty young girl he saw with
this person they're talking about who absconded with the funds.
Yeah. And then she shows up at Rutland
with another hair color. Chestnut brown, I think.
Yeah, some kind of mousy brown. Now, Mark, unlike Strutt, doesn't do his own hiring. Or has given different instructions to his hiring manager, which do include getting references for everybody, even pretty girls. But he sees her and he thinks and he connects her with this figure and he's already fascinated.
Well, his hiring manager has already pretty much decided on a middle-aged woman or older than middle-aged. He assures her that he thinks she'll be hearing from them very soon.
Except that we see the distaste on Mark's face for this matronly woman.
That's right. Mark wants a Marnie type.
Who's the Star Trek woman again?
Marriott Hartley.
Yeah, I think he just wants, you know, attractive young women around like Marriott Hartley, but with good references.
Probably, yeah. But I think the key is that Marnie trumps everything else. She is the wild card in the waiting room, and they bring her in. The personnel manager interrogates her, and it's clear that she would not normally be up to snuff, but Mark is leaning against the walls of the office or the building that he owns, gestures or gives the signal to the personnel manager that we're going to hire this woman.
The way Connery is playing this role, everything is detached and ironic.
He's pretty amazing in this movie. And I'm not a Sean Connery fan, generally.
So as she's giving her story, he's making all of these ironic faces. He doesn't believe a single word she said. And of course, Tippi Hedren at various different points has to put on all kinds of different acts. She's lying most of the time with a different story at different parts of the movie. And here she's just laying it on ridiculously thick, right?
But you have to imagine that she did go and get that job in Pittsburgh for a little while because they did call them and they got references from them. So she lays out her schemes quite methodically. One thing that this movie does, because we've already seen during her visit to her mom's, she suffers from nightmares. She's troubled by all kinds of triggers, like the color red, like lightning and thunder. This just ups the ante so much. We've seen lots of movies where you're protecting antagonist, the identification character, is a con artist or criminal in some way. I don't think I've ever seen a movie where the person that is going to be running all these scams is so vulnerable in some ways. Yeah. Like, she can be tripped up in a million different ways. It's so brave of her to continue in this mode of life.
It's not brave, it's compulsive, obviously. And Mark points all of this out, right? You're not doing fine.
No, she's definitely not.
You could get in a lot worse trouble than me.
She's so competent, except when she sees the color red or lightning.
I love the scene where she spills the red ink on her blouse, because the way she goes running out of there and is frantically in the bathroom scrubbing the ink, but when people are asking her what's wrong with you, she doesn't even know she's freaking out. She's so dissociated, she doesn't even know she's freaking out. She's like, why are you freaking out? I'm just getting ink off my blouse. Brilliant. It's psychologically brilliant. But so much of this movie is the mood and the atmosphere Hitchcock creates, even just with these office scenes where she's like ingratiating herself with the chatty secretary who's, you know, immediately characterized as the chatty secretary who's going to give her all of the information that she needs to do this robbery. The office manager who's absent-minded, another stupid old man who the movie's making fun of. And the women are ironically exchanging glances about him as he forgets his safe code for the fifth time in a row. The way the camera is just gliding around the office and doing all these weird angle shots on Tippi Hedren's forehead and face. That's just all about her thinking and all about her interiority, right, that we're occupying. And the lush Bernard Herrmann music going at the same time, and the color scheme of the movie, which I've heard described as avoidance of red. It's a very distinctive color scheme, but it's not avoidance of red and related shades. It's just very strategic use of them. This movie is just like Psycho, like The Birds, and I feel like he starts doing this, well, he periodically does it, like even Rebecca's like this, but starting with Vertigo, and then even more so with Psycho, The Birds, he's just making movies that are worlds that you occupy and that you feel and that you live inside.
Well, what about Rear Window?
Yeah, obviously, that too. So the next big set piece and advance in her relationship with Mark, and we see him, you know, at the end of that ink spill episode, again, watching her, trying to figure out what's going on with her, just like we are, right? We know more than he does, but we're still pretty baffled. And so he asks her to work on a Saturday. This is part of his seduction scheme. He's already obviously obsessed with this woman, although we don't fully know that yet, but why else would he have hired her instead of going to the police?
Well, he said he wasn't sure.
Yeah, exactly.
And how could you be?
But, I mean, his motives for installing her are dubious. He doesn't know yet that she's frigid.
Oh, no, of course not. He must be thinking that she's, you know, a practiced seductress and criminal femme fatale, right? That's what you would expect, but
the other great thing about Hedren's performance and the way she's directed is that Marnie does, when she's not triggered, Marnie does have total composure.
Mm-hmm. The thing is, that is her big selling point. Yes, she's a beautiful woman, but Martin Gable's not entirely lying when he talks about, you know, how competent she is and how trustworthy and level-headed she seems, right? He clearly didn't get anywhere with her if he was thinking he might have some office nookie, so he just gets someone to look at and someone who's a really good secretary until she takes off with his money.
Yeah, I'm not sure that Strutt even was looking for anything other than decorating the place,
right,
as they comment.
But in most narratives, you know, she would be a criminal that insinuates herself into the lives of powerful men by using sexuality. She really doesn't, other than
getting
the way
job.
She looks.
Yeah, getting the job. Yeah. So this is another absolutely insane scene that makes use of what I was saying, you know, the post-dubbed voices that are far too calm for what's going on and far too quiet. The switch from the storm to the branch crashing through the window and destroying all these artifacts, these mementos of his late wife, and the crazy Herrmann music, then we get absolute silence again. And in the midst of this insane calm, Sean Connery is just like, you know, we should go now. I need to get the maintenance people in here.
This place is wrecked.
And in the midst of all this, we get the smothering, erotic, oppressive close-up of him forcing himself on her while she's completely out of it, right? That kiss that's like a rape, but it's also like porn. You know what it's always reminded me of? I saw the movie before I read Henry James's The Golden Bull, but there are descriptions of, like, erotic descriptions of faces, like Maggie describing Amerigo's face coming towards hers for a kiss, and it's like that. It's like the most giant, oppressive, frightening, erotic thing that you can imagine, right? And these aren't normal close-ups. It's not classical Hollywood cinema shooting style.
No, definitely not. He's going off on his own here. We learn a lot about Mark in this scene. He's not just the head of a publishing concern.
He's an intellectual of the sort.
He had been on the academic path, it sounds like. He was an aspiring zoologist who was drawn into the business affairs of his family. They had run the publishing company into the ground and he had to save it. Marriott Hartley tells us this, but here we find out what he would prefer to do, which is study predators. And here, of course, that ties into what he thinks Marnie is, a predator. He talks about how he trained a jaguarundi.
To trust him.
That's a great deal with a jaguarundi.
Because she's being very cool and ironic and dismissive with him. Kind of ambiguous whether she's trying to dismiss flirtation or sort of flirting.
Well, we'll never know because it starts to thunder and lightning and that's it for whatever composure she has. She freaks out.
And yeah, there's these weird gestures she makes, weird expressions she makes. Have to be what Hitchcock was asking her for. You know, like that mouth movement.
Does have a kind of childlike cast to it, bringing her right back to this moment she doesn't consciously remember. When a man showed up in the middle of the night, rapped on the window, this was the signal to her sex worker mother that it was time for Marnie to leave the bed, open for the adults. She's right back there, even though she doesn't know what it is.
So what we have to discuss then is the theme of this episode, the terms of the marriage, the rape scene, how this all resolves into a relationship where he is her caregiver and
psychologist.
Freud. He's her Freud. Me, Dora, you Freud. He's proceeding quickly toward marriage.
There's a lot that happens before that point.
Not that much.
Their courtship progresses to some extent in an almost normal way. They go to the races when he finds out that she's crazy for horses.
He finds out that at the races that she believes in nothing.
That's what she says. She gives away a few important little details of her past that he's able to follow up on later. A man accosts her, clearly another one of her victims, thinking that she's Peggy Nicholson. Sean Connery gets a lot of delight out of giving this man the bum's rush. Quit pushing your luck, old bean, or whatever. He calls her old bean at one point.
Well, yeah, this family is supposed to be, I don't know, American aristocracy, even though Sean Connery is talking in a Scottish accent and his father's talking in a British accent, and I don't know what's going on. But...
Well, yeah, the father is Alan Napier. He's great. What a weird character. He is just benignly looking on most of the time. He likes horses. He likes Marnie because she likes horses. And most of all, he loves catering by Horn and Hardart.
And the way that Connery talks about him, you know, he has his dad completely down psychologically.
My dad approves of men who take the initiative.
This is kind of the movie's flaw. But as Marnie keeps saying, Mark is almost the more interesting character because he presents himself with such psychological wisdom, right? He understands everybody around him, and he seems to understand himself very thoroughly, right? This whole account he gives of his relationship to his dead wife and her mortality, but he's masochistically obsessed with this woman.
Well, yeah, and it does cause him to do something terrible, as we've discussed already, as we've led off the podcast.
But because Marnie is the protagonist, the subject of the movie, we never explore Mark's psychology, and that creates a power imbalance in the movie, right? So that all of the question of what exactly he is doing is left unresolved at the end of the movie.
No, but there are lots of hints, and I do, like, the way he talks about his dad, it's not that different from Robert Stack in Written on the Wind. I mean, he's not his dad's favorite icon of manhood.
No, I mean, he steps up a lot, you know, after he marries Marnie.
He's done something bold for a change.
What does he say? Dad likes a good, wholesome, red-blooded lust or whatever?
Yeah, animal lust.
Animal lust. And action. That's what his dad likes. And obviously Mark has typically been, despite being, you know, brawny, handsome, charismatic, sexy Sean Connery, he's always been a thinker.
Yeah, a zoologist.
Relationship between the two, presented in those terms, is almost like Henry Fonda and Barbara Stanwyck in The Lady Eve, except this is not very funny.
Well, there's some funny moments. But everything changes when Marnie goes ahead with her plan to rob Connery's firm.
Right, I mean, she's practically on the verge of getting engaged, so if she doesn't want to get entangled, she's going to have to get out of there right now.
And that's what she says later, and you believe it, right? It steps up her timetable.
It's very hard to say the way the scenes, you know, other than that first crazy kiss during the storm, the way her scenes with him are filmed, it's not made obvious that she is just leading him on.
She says that she liked him, and he agrees that he thinks that that's probably true, but no more than that. She wasn't falling in love with him, of course.
And in that moment, when he agrees with her, like, she says, "Oh no, Mark, not you, I liked you." And he's like, "Yes, I think you did." And then she immediately turns her head away in a quite an ambiguous way that could mean that she thinks she just had him on. But I'm not sure that she's right if she thinks that.
No, she's clearly not right. She was having fun when they're talking about horses, right? You can't picture that happening with Martin Gable. It's a little bit different, but not different in the way that con artist falls in love with victim type movies usually are. She still wants to rob him and get away, maybe even more so, because she doesn't want to take any chances with having to come close to sex.
One of the things that I read, there's actually been a whole book published, although I never read it, on The Making of Marnie. That's what it's called, The Making of Marnie. One of the things I read online about the production was that Tippi Hedren asked Hitchcock, "How am I supposed to play frigid around Sean Connery?" He must have loved that, Hitchcock. Since famously, we haven't even brought this up, but famously, throughout the whole production of the movie, Hitchcock was pressuring Tippi Hedren to have sex with him. Abundantly clear over and over, she did not want to do and wasn't going to do. Obviously, the movie is... I mean, that's the great hall of mirrors of this movie. The fact that all these men in the movie that are being interrogated, right, for their sexual harassment or their sexual aggression, obsession with Marnie.
Hitchcock was living it.
Yeah.
And acting upon
it. And Hitchcock was not reflective about it in his personal life at all.
Well, he obviously was in the movie. He let those thoughts get into the film.
Once again, trust the tale, not the teller.
Yeah, her experience with Hitchcock was so perilous that she decided, and was kind of forced to, I guess, to go take it easy and live a much more secure life on a compound with, like, 100 lions and tigers.
For one thing, he wouldn't let her out of her contract, and he also wouldn't make any more movies with her because she refused to sleep with him. So that ruined her career, because though this movie wasn't a huge success, obviously this was like a star-making performance, and she could have got other leads in films if he didn't want to work with her. And yeah, as you said, she was so completely traumatized by these two movies, because he had been kind of psychologically and physically torturing her during The Birds as well, by that crazy scene where she did get hurt of the bird attacks, that yeah, she seemed to have to deal with this trauma by being mauled by lions. She became Mark, really.
She did. She didn't try to tame a jaguarundi. She went for even bigger game. So once he tracks her down, I mean, he does all this detective work. There are two detectives in the movie because Diane Baker gets involved in her own case of the mysterious bride later on. He finds her in her most vulnerable spot, hanging out with Florio at the stable.
It sounds like the hero of a Harlequin romance, Florio.
Oh, Florio!
She does say, "Oh, Florio."
She does.
"Oh, Florio, if you want to bite someone, bite me."
The horse is the only being that she has any kind of relationship with, any kind of traditional relationship with in the movie. Everyone else, the defenses are up, the claws are out, and he lays it all out for her on their drive back. He is going to force her to marry him. They're going to get to the bottom of what's troubling her, and in the meantime, he's gone around paying off whatever he can of the debts that she's accrued by theft.
And she keeps telling him, "You're crazy. You're crazy. Why would you want to do this? What do you care? Just let me go. Let me out of here.
If you love me, you should definitely let me go away from here."
Yeah, when he says that, she for a moment thinks, because she didn't even imagine that he could actually be in love with her, right? And she, for a moment, like, she has this revelation. "Oh, you'll let me go then. You love me." No, wrong. Opposite.
But he says, "No, I'm responsible for you. I can't let you go out and continue to rob people. I've got to take charge here." It's a very complicated situation here, because you're like, well, when you're watching that scene and the scenes immediately thereafter, you're like, no, this is not fair. This guy is backing her into a corner and clearly using power relations to get what he wants. On the other hand, you kind of start to believe that, you know, maybe he can help her. Except the tension in the whole movie.
Yeah, the additional tension of that is realizing that yeah, he is crazy. This is a crazy thing he's doing.
Oh yeah, of course. He's a co-conspirator at this point. Of course, we see what that entails later on when she starts divulging all the other capers she's pulled, and he has to add up, okay, well, who do we have to pay off for this one? Who do we have to pay off for this one?
And by the time he marries her, he does know verbally, although he hasn't experienced what it entails, that she doesn't have sex with men, that she has no interest in men.
Right. And he just figures that'll we'll take care of that in the course of things.
When they actually get on their honeymoon, building up to the rape scene, that's when he lays it out that you're lucky you got me. I'm such a tolerant man. I'm such a enlightened man that I'm not going to immediately rape you. If you'd been caught by a strut, you know, you probably would have gotten the rape and the jail time. Both.
Yeah. And I don't think he's wrong.
I'm Prince Charming compared to what the fate you could have come across.
Yeah, it's a pretty double-edged statement because he's right, but on the other hand, he turns out to be horrible too. He is better than those other guys. And it's definitely not laying out any kind of guide to behavior. Even Mark, despite all the impish delight he's been deriving from his efforts to track her and trap her and hopefully tame her from his perspective, he loses it.
I honestly, I couldn't tell you. I haven't made a study of this. I don't know what the real life motivations for rape are. But by the time Mark actually rapes her, what we've seen is he's not doing it out of a, I'm going to cure her of her frigidity.
No, he's just...
he's just acting out of lust.
Yeah, he can't control himself anymore.
Obsessive lust. And that has... in the women's romance novels, up to and including Gone with the Wind, that has typically been an excusable mistake. The man should feel very, very bad about it afterwards. Rhett Butler actually has misplaced guilt about it, because he feels so terrible about it, because he was really drunk, that he doesn't even notice that Scarlett actually is cured of her frigidity by his rape. He doesn't notice how extremely happy she is the next day, which sets them off on a whole brand new path of tragic misunderstanding. So that's like the irresponsible romance novel way to do it. But this is still within the broad romance novel tradition of the excusable lust rape that doesn't seem really to bear any relationship to real life raping. And certainly even if that is a motive, it's not in real life a forgivable motive.
No, and it's even more disturbing the way it's shot because he rips her clothes off, he apologizes to her.
And then he becomes, he makes love to her tenderly while she, quite believably, now this part is quite believable of how I've heard rape victims describe a rape. She just absolutely zones out, blanks out.
Yeah, she's catatonic.
Absent, she's catatonic, she's absent, she's not there. And that is the face that Hitchcock wanted in the frame. That is what it registers, catatonia. And then, yes, we get the polite look away to the raging sea.
It's not raging, though. That's the really weird thing there. It's a placid sea, from what I recall.
Anyway. Well, I don't know. Is it then reflecting her own catatonic state?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
That's the thing about the whole way it's shot, because the music and Mark's attitude signals to us that this is a romantic love scene, and her attitude, and some of the notes of the music playing over her face, signal that that is not the case.
Right. Yeah, and Hitchcock did all of that. Did he understand how brilliant it all is? I don't know.
Who's Hitchcock? That's the question. Who's Hitchcock? The man who made the movie or the man who tells the dirty jokes and harasses Tippi Hedren?
Well, both. And legally, he's more the one that was harassing Tippi Hedren. He probably should have been in jail by the end of this movie, or long before it was made.
Well, yeah, my whole theory, of course, about why he harassed Tippi Hedren but had not done this. He'd been crude with actresses before, but had not sexually harassed them to this extent, was obviously that she was a nobody.
Yeah, they all had separate power bases. I mean, he couldn't behave this way toward Ingrid Bergman. I'm sure he wanted to.
Or Grace Kelly, or Vera Miles, etc., etc. Yeah.
So after she tries to kill herself, the honeymoon is cut short.
I do love their return home where Mark is trying to coach her on how they will behave normally in their in their marriage of convenience or marriage of inconvenience. He's gone back into his ironic, detached mode and he's blah, 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 blah talking and she just quietly closes the door in his face. That's a great moment.
Now, she's got an antagonist inside the house, played by Diane Baker.
Yeah, so very shades of written on the wind here, except Diane Baker's a lot calmer than Dorothy Malone. His impish kid sister type. She's had a crush on him since childhood, I guess.
Well, since he married her older sister.
Right.
She wants to replace her older sister. That didn't work out.
But he does not see her that way. Plus, I don't know, maybe he can only get a boner for women who are exploiting him. Who knows? Or hate him. Or think he's disgusting. Who knows what was going on with that marriage?
Yeah, I wonder if the novel goes more into what his first marriage was like.
I mean, after this, things get very plotty for a long time, and we don't need to dwell on those mechanics. The important thing is...
She's starting to even seem like she's enjoying playing the role of social hostess.
She likes him very much, as long as he doesn't try to have sex with her.
Right.
But unfortunately, he still very much wants to do that. But now he's contenting himself to reading psychological treatises on sexual aberrations
in of the criminal female.
Of the criminal female. And he's continuing to try to play this informal psychologist role with her. We get that fantastic nightmare sequence, right? Very expressionistic, with that horrifyingly creepy detached man's hand tapping on the dream window. It is reminiscent of Vertigo's circular kiss shot, right? Where don't we briefly go back into the past of the stables while it's circling around? Right? So there's two realities coexisting in this room.
Yeah, she's on the old cot that she would have been reposing on as a child. She doesn't seem to be in the Rutherford mansion.
But then we cut across to the door and that is where she is.
Mark walks in and she sees him, as she sees all men, as a monstrous assailant. He's certainly not helping her break out of her nightmare, and Diane Baker has to come and help out. And she says, this is supposed to be your department, old bean, or whatever. Supposed to be able to comfort your wife. And then he begins playing word association games with her.
She has too much hubris here, because she wants to fight back at his hypocrisy again, and say, how dare you psychoanalyze me? I don't even want your help. Which is true. He's sort of raping her in this way, too, because she is not asking for his help. He is forcing his help on her, right? She honestly just wants him to leave her alone, and he will not. So now he's going to get inside her head instead, right? So she's trying to throw it back at him and point out, as she always does, that he's just as crazy as she is. But she's too vulnerable, so she can never win this battle, right?
No, all they have to do is mention Red. Her facade crumbles. She does ask him for help at the end of that scene as she breaks down.
She does, but she also looks like she looks like she's embracing him and fighting the embrace at the same time.
Well, yeah, I think she is.
She doesn't want to go to him for help.
No.
Want anyone's help, let alone his.
But all of this has been exacerbated by the arrival of Martin Gable at the party. He was invited by Diane Baker. And this wrecks any kind of structure they had attempted to build for her. Martin Gable is told that she's not the person he thinks she is, but the jig is up. They have to start planning for the inevitable blowback. Sean Connery is just laying out what he's going to do, how he's going to damage control this.
And it's very foolish of him, knowing how fragile Marnie is, to tell her that she's going to have to keep up appearances by going on this hunt the next day.
Yeah, and that just goes completely haywire. When she sees all the dogs and these bloodthirsty humans in on the kill of this fox, I guess, we don't really see the fox. We know that's what's happening, and she knows she associates herself with this victim. She just completely flips out and drives Forio to death, ultimately.
I've mentioned it before, but that shot where she's riding across the plain and Lil is riding after her, camera just goes back and back and back and back until there are these little dots on the field. It's just such an extraordinary cinematic representation of anxiety. It could be like a modernist painting.
In microcosm, it encapsulates her life. Running, 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 and she winds up hurting herself and hurting this being, this only friend that she's ever had, Forio.
What do you think of, because there's been a lot of controversy on the way that, the very fake looking way and curious editing of the horse's crash into the wall and her springing through the air. What do you think about it?
I loved it. I mean, I don't want to see a real horse getting hurt on a wall.
Sure, but I imagine it could be more disguised. Like, it's very blatantly fake.
It's a symbolic crash.
Well, not just that, but for me, I thought that he was trying to go for, and it works for me, as intense a point of view of the crash as possible.
Of course.
And that necessarily involves some amount of fakery.
Yeah, I'm not bothered by it at all. It achieves the intended effect.
If you wanted it to look realistic, you were going to need more of a long shot, right? Than what we get.
Yeah, no, that's not the point here. The point is to show she's killing herself here, really. I mean, even more than when she tried to drown herself. This is worse. When she kills Forio, who means more to her than her own life.
And those horse legs on the wall, I don't care how fake they are, they look awful.
Yeah, I shriek.
Awful.
Yeah.
And then this scene is an absolute tour de force by Tippi Hedren. It doesn't matter how many times I've watched this movie, I end up sobbing through it. Of course, always the shooting of an injured animal has that pathos anyway, but the way she just retreats into childhood, but at the same time...
She's got a gun.
She's frantically violent. And then that horrible phrase that she says after she kills somebody. There now.
Yeah, the way she's been living, death seems preferable, I think.
Well, that's part of her associations, right? She gets triggered by her own associations before, well, and also by what Mark is pulling out for her even before the red, death me, right?
All she can think of to do next, of course, is to run away. This is all happening while Mark is meeting with Strutt and arranging to pay everybody off. He's already told her that he thinks, because she's so crazy, any reputable psychologist will recognize that, and as long as they make restitution, she'll probably get a suspended sentence, and the movie leads you to think that this is true. He's accurate in that regard. But yeah, he gets the call. He knows immediately where she would have gone, back to the safe. He intervenes and he tells her he's been investigating her mother. He wouldn't have known about the mother. Diane Baker's contributions are important, even though she's not trying to help Marnie. She ultimately does, because she's the one that intercepted the call to Mom down in Baltimore.
There's also a lot of controversy about this crazy scene where she's literally paralyzed and cannot reach the money and she's trying to fight her own paralysis.
Yeah.
Right? The filming of that. But the craziest part of it is when Mark tries to force her to take the money and you're asked to believe that all of his strength on this tiny woman cannot get her hand to budge.
She's got some powerful neuroses. And I think, well, he wants to convince her to do it herself. He's just trying to nudge her. He's not actually pushing her with his...
No, I think he is.
180 pounds or 200 pounds or whatever.
He is doing that. Yes. He's not nudging her.
And what he's telling her is this is your money.
It's not a realistic scene. Yeah. Shades of Fallen Angel from our last episode.
Yeah.
That's what Alice Faye says to Dane Andrews.
Yeah. You can't steal from me because I love you and we have everything in common property wise. He says, okay, we're going to see Mom.
And she's just a sweaty, disheveled wreck at this point.
He takes the gun away from her and fixes her hair a bit.
Yeah. That gun could definitely have been used on him. So he was a little bit worried there for a moment.
And then we have this huge epiphany, talk therapy triumph.
As we said in our Fear and Moviegoing quick discussion of the movie, the hysteria of this final scene and the weirdly iconic shots at the climax of the murder of the man's bleeding head, Bruce Dern, and the freaking out mother and the freaking out daughter. This is unprecedented in Hitchcock. He never did anything like this before. As far as I know, he doesn't do anything like it again. I haven't seen all of his later movies. And it's hyper-hysterical, hyper-stylized. Again, you know, shades of David Lynch at his craziest. And again, it's the contagious hysteria between the past and present mother and daughter has me just a sobbing wreck by the end of the movie. And that's obviously the point.
Yeah.
That's the point of it. This hysteria. It's supposed to be this frenzied, but it's also supposed to have this genuine emotional catharsis behind it. So what do you think of what prompts the murder here?
Well, it's pretty disturbing. I mean, it's a customer of a sex worker who seems to want to add the, what, six or however old she is, daughter?
It's quite ambiguous whether, because of what he says afterwards, the way his comforting of her is filmed is ambiguous. Coupled with his reaction after, you could tell yourself, and I have seen some critics tell themselves, that the mother's already hysterical and already is distrustful of men, and he wasn't actually trying to do anything to the little girl.
No, but why?
But even if he wasn't,
he shouldn't be touching a child. He's in the house to have sex with the mother and then leave. I mean, that's the business arrangement. There's no time for becoming Uncle John here.
But I was also thinking on this viewing, too, that even if this particular sailor wasn't intending pedophilia,
someone else.
Maybe someone else did to create this hysteria in both of them already. Also, as we said, the fight, the murder, which is insanely filmed, where the mother gets the accident, the leg injury, right? With his filmed with his leg in between her legs, and you know, it's the Freudian primal scene. So what Marnie is reacting to, in other words, is not just this actual terrible traumatic sexual thing that happened, violent sexual thing that happened when she was a child, but also the universal, according to Freud, or at least universal for 19th century Western bourgeois children, fantasy, imagination, child's imagination of the parental sex act, which is that the father is injuring the mother. This is where feminists, I've noticed some feminist writers, want to start talking about the queer mother-daughter relationship in this movie. Because Marnie's in love with her mother. This is very fitting for going into an Akerman movie. Marnie's in love with her mother. She treats her as if... She treats her like Mark treats Marnie. And she's trying to win her love, buy her love, be her sugar daddy.
And Jesse is a rival in love.
Yeah. And it's clear, like, from this early transposed primal scene, that from the beginning she doesn't want anything to do with men at all. She only wants to do with her mother.
And the horse. That's about it.
Well, later on, the horse.
Right.
That men are repulsive to her inherently, wherever that started. It's before the scene that we see that this started.
Well, yeah, because, well, and she gets that from her mother. Her mother hates herself. We know that. She found religion afterwards and became a Bible thumper. She hates herself for being a sex worker. That's a powder keg right there. So all of the conditions were right for this guy getting killed. All he had to do was walk out and notice the daughter, and it was going to happen, probably. I think it's an incredible climax to the movie. We probably talked about this briefly in Fear and Moviegoing a year or two ago whenever we did it. Would finding out about this actually cure you of all your problems? I mean, that's the conceit, I guess, of psychotherapy, but I'm not sure. I mean, it's the same thing in Spellbound, right?
Well, I mean, even Freud had to admit that the talking cure doesn't quite work that way.
It gives you some tools to manage your problems, I'm sure, but it doesn't dispel them.
No, but narratively, right, in a narrative,
yeah,
it makes sense. I don't think we're supposed to believe that these two are walking away from this incident and their problems are solved and they have no more marital or psychological problems.
Well, it's true, and she still has a problem with her mother. I mean...
Oh yeah, the movie doesn't sentimentalize that. They have like 1 second of rapprochement where Marnie realizes, theoretically, that her mother loves her, but her mother still can't express it.
No, she's still gonna need her Jessie doll. So, there's a great love movie. Let's turn our attention to La Captive by Chantal Akerman.
I think maybe the real lovers in the movie were Marnie and her mother. So La Captive is based on, I think it's the 5th volume of A la Recherche.
A la Recherche du Temps Perdu.
Yeah, you better pronounce it for us, Dave.
I've only read volume 1, like many, many people.
I wanted to read the whole thing before this, and I did give myself enough time, but a lot of real life stuff and other interests intervened, and I'm only halfway through the 2nd volume. Which, however, is enough to already have a taste of how Proust handles his obsessive theme of obsessive, possessive, jealous love.
That's true. Well, we know how little Marcel felt about his mother.
Well, no, I'm thinking of the Swan in Love,
right,
section, further developed in the 2nd volume, when little Marcel has his own first love with Swan's daughter. There is a relationship here to Hitchcock that Akerman was aware of, which is that she borrows from Vertigo.
In the pursuit scene.
Yeah, in the stalker pursuit scenes. She has some interesting things to say in that interview we watched about the similarities and differences herself as a filmmaker to Hitchcock. And as to why she chose Proust, I read somewhere that it was her producer's idea, but she jumped at it, and she talks in that interview too about, you know, her lifelong affinity for Proust as a French speaker who, well, she doesn't say this exactly, she implies it, who is Jewish and homosexual.
She said she doesn't agree with his judgments on art, but everything else, the subject matter he treated, is very congenial to her, she said.
This is not a costume drama. It's set in an ambiguous present of the filmmaking time.
They drive modern-ish looking cars.
Which was the year 2000.
They have telephones. They don't have cell phones, though.
It makes the relationship even more strange and abstract, why this young woman is living in... But, I mean, I'm sure weird rich men still can have paid companions. It happens in the TV show Succession. Connor and Willa. And they get married, so there you go.
Well, she doesn't seem to be poor. I mean, her aunt also has this mansion out in the country.
Yeah, true.
I don't think she's dependent on him for money.
They're living in a strange arrangement.
Oh, very strange. And we never find out how they met, how their courtship began.
Courtship, yeah.
Well, he says they had some happy times, but that's been lost. By the time we meet them, he is in a spiral of jealousy and suspicion.
All we gather about them by the end of the movie is that at one time she was living as a lesbian, and he's taken her away from that, and that concerns him a lot.
Yeah.
It has driven him insane, in fact.
Well, when we meet him, he's watching home videos of Ariane and several of her girlfriends on the beaches of Normandy, and he just tells all of these girls that he loves them. That's his confession at the beginning of the movie. He's in love with the feeling of closeness between these women that he can't share. I mean, he doesn't say all of that, but that's what the movie is about.
Somewhat, yeah. Some of what the movie is about.
Because he feels on the outside of all of this, and she is like a black box to him, I mean, he's just been getting more and more insane. And he's got her friend André sort of deputized to shadow Ariane everywhere she goes and report back to him.
But he doesn't trust her reports at all.
No, and they talk about how much faith they have in each other.
If anything, he's worried about something going on between her and...
André. Yeah, well, why wouldn't he be? He's looking at Ariane and André in the video on the beach.
Yeah, but I guess he's, as you say, he's sort of deputized her, so he's decided, okay, well, this much is okay, as long as I can use her for information on any other lesbian shenanigans. And this already does occur in the Swan in Love volume. Swan is very jealous of Odette's relationship with other men, but he goes particularly mental when he finds out that she has also had relations with women. But it's not developed very far at that point. Critics of Proust talk about, obviously, he was homosexual, and in some of the cases, including this volume, no one lovers of his were used as models for the women that the narrator is obsessed with, which has led critics to think that the narrator's actual concern is with the lovers, the female lovers of these male lovers. And that's why lesbianism becomes this weird source of jealousy. But I'm not so sure about that. Like, already the little bit I've read in the first volume and a half, the way love presents itself for Proust's male consciousnesses is the desire to have knowledge of any part of the beloved's life that they do not have knowledge of. That is love.
Mm-hmm.
And that inaccessibility drives the love, but it's also destroying the relationship.
Yeah, and that's what Chantal Akerman seizes upon and just goes with. I have no idea how closely it hews to the events in the novel, in the section of the novel.
I mean, I do know that the ending of the lover, or the beloved, is both similar and different.
Well, just at the big picture level, we just get a lot of detail about their daily lives together, such as they are, the sexual routine they have.
Yeah, so Akerman talks about how her framing, her compositions in this movie are a return to Jean Dielman after she'd spent a lot of time resisting that because that movie was hailed as a masterpiece when she was very young, and obviously she, you know, was trying to escape from self-repetition. But she let herself go back to that for this movie, and so there feels like there's very much not just a stylistic but a emotional continuity between the movies. And she does admit that these claustrophobic interiors, you know, she's a very self-aware writer, that they have to do with the mother figure again, right? And so, much as in Jean Dielman, for the first part of this movie, we're just seeing people engaged in, well, in Jean Dielman, the main characters engaged in very mundane rituals. But here, they're engaged in very weird rituals that are nevertheless just as sort of mundane to them, right, as, you know, making coffee and peeling potatoes is to Jean Dielman.
Yeah.
But there's a ritualistic and a routine aspect to his following of her, to his interrogations of her and her friend, to their sexual relations that consist of him asking her to pretend to sleep while he masturbates on her.
Mm-hmm. And according to Akerman, this is pleasurable for both.
Yeah, well,
that's what she says in the interview.
The artist says something that doesn't communicate clearly on the screen. We can ignore them.
But I'm not sure that she's wrong.
Well, the woman is sleeping, or I mean pretending to sleep. It's important that her pleasure isn't obvious.
Right. Of course. And it's important to him, too, it seems to be. But she tells him over and over again that she does love him. She is happy with their life together.
Well, she always asks, do you want me to come now? Because they have separate rooms. And sometimes this is what's so strange and mistress-like about the relationship. They have separate rooms. And when he wants her for sex, he'll either go to her room or get her to come to his room.
They might play checkers first.
Yeah, do something very boring. The way that Sylvie Testud plays the character initially, though, there's something in her very eagerness, her very readiness to do whatever he wants that makes it feel like she is... It's all fake.
Yeah, but it can't be, right? Because it clearly means a lot to her, this relationship.
We know that by the end.
Yeah.
But we don't know that at the beginning.
Well,
and that's
no, because
what's important.
Yeah, we're seeing her through his eyes at the beginning, and he doesn't believe that she's into this relationship
and
anymore.
And from the way she behaves, we can understand why he doesn't believe that.
It's true, but that's what he wants her to be like. It's very complex layering here, because he's like, okay, go to sleep so I can come on you. Then he's brooding on this, I guess. It's like, well, she's just sleeping through our whole relationship. But that's what he wants. That's what turns him on. It's very disturbing. And it seems to be what she wants, but she's content with it, although she has other things in her life. She has an active social life that he is disturbed by because there's all kinds of attractive women around.
Yeah, but you must see, it's not as simple as that. Like, you must see how opaque she seems and how he could be misinterpreting all of this.
Right, but what I'm saying is that this is what he wants her to be like. This is what drives his desire. If she wasn't like this, he wouldn't have these feelings about her.
You mean her blankness?
Yeah.
Yeah, but the blankness also causes him to distrust whether she actually feels anything for him.
Yeah, exactly. It's a no-win situation.
And he thinks that she must be keeping her actual passion elsewhere.
Yeah, and she assures him that's not true. This is my actual
passion.
This
just is. This is just it. This is it. There's no more. There's no more to me. But there's many things that cast doubt on that as well. For me, this feels less like Proust, although I haven't read the volume yet, so who knows, than at many moments it feels so much like Henry James. I'm going to say, enjoy your drinking game out there, listeners, because it feels so much at moments like The Sacred Fount or The Golden Bowl.
Or The Blithedale Romance by Hawthorne.
Where you don't know whether the narrator, the protagonist in this case, which is initially him, is insane and paranoid, or whether he is... Again, he plays the role of psychologist in this movie too, so that connects him to Mark. At moments, it's like the turn of the screw, as he more and more starts trying to investigate her lesbian life and understand it. He starts psychoanalyzing her, telling her that she has all of these feelings that she claims she doesn't have. And we don't know until the ending seems to slant in the direction of he's been wrong all along. But for the longest time, we don't know whether, you know, like the governess in The Turn of the Screw, whether he's not just performing some kind of disastrous therapy on her that she doesn't want, that she really has... And there were hints of this in Akerman's interview, that she's hidden her sexuality from herself so well that he can perceive it, but she can't. In his paranoia, he can detect it, but she is in complete denial about it. Moments that give weight to that possibility are those moments when she's singing with the other women, right?
Well, these other women in her life are clearly important to her. But are they erotically important to her? Are they...
Yes, absolutely.
...a threat to him? It seems like no, according to her.
But yes, they are, because it's made clear in the course of the movie that she was having lesbian relationships with these women before she was with him.
Yeah, but what she tells him, again, this is all near the end, tells him that the fact that she doesn't understand him at all, that she couldn't sing along with him because they're just totally alien to one another, this is what she likes.
Yes, but I mean, let's talk about the evolution of his paranoia beyond these early rituals that we see, and her early blankness, opacity, over-eagerness to please him, as if she has no will, no desires of her own. But with a blank, tepid sort of desire to please him too, that's not so erotically exaggerated that he could understand that as a real desire to please him.
And again, this is clearly what is turning him on about her, but also driving him crazy.
Yeah.
The fact that she says, yeah, it's okay, do whatever you want, look at my vagina.
You want me
vagina.
To come? You want me to come?
But it's important that she says that, and when you tie it into what she says at the end of the movie, it's clear that, yeah, that's why she's offering to come to his room, because she likes this.
But after he's observed some of these incidents, this completely inaccessible, incomprehensible, all-female world to which she has no access. So this is the ultimate representation of this Proustian idea of love as being driven by, as being compelled toward, whatever is inaccessible about the lover's life. And here, lesbianism is like the perfect representation of that, of this total otherness. And so he goes to see these lesbians.
Yeah, he goes to the lesbian community and asks them for some tips or some prognostication on his chances.
And these lesbians tell him, again, exactly what he wants to hear, which is exactly what he doesn't want to hear, but he wants his paranoia to be confirmed. And they give it to him. They say, yeah, absolutely. If, we're not sure, but if she's into women, then yeah, you have no chance.
Right.
Even if she's also into men, if she's into women, she's not going to be as into you as she is with a woman, because with a woman, it's just, we can't describe how, but it's just completely and utterly different and not the same. I mean, one way to describe it, they say, is, well, with a man, you're enemies. And with a woman, you know. But then they go off on little tangents like, do you, one of them asks the other one, who's probably her lover.
Oh, yeah, they are. They say that.
They do say that. Asks her, do you tend to forget who you're with? And she's like, yes, I forget who I'm with every time. And she's like, really? Yes, because you close your eyes and you can think of whoever you want. So then it even goes beyond lesbianism, right? Because anyone you're with at any time could just be, they have this completely inaccessible fantasy life that may have nothing to do with you, and, which is common.
Yeah, likely they do.
And it doesn't even have to be an erotic fantasy life. It can be any kind of inner life, because that's what they start discussing on this drive. By the way, this movie is really funny,
mm-hmm.
as Akerman usually is. The absurd things that they are saying to each other and the comic rhythms of it alongside these obsessive rituals that they're performing.
And you have the bystanders around the house. There's Françoise, the housekeeper, who thinks all of this is very strange, I'm sure. There's the chauffeur, who sometimes has to move over to the passenger side when Ariane wants to drive.
And the man, Simon, he's confined to the house by illness. He's allergic to everything.
Pollen, especially.
He's got Eddie Bracken. Eddie Bracken hay fever. The spots. This is why he can't go with them. Like, often they invite him to go with them, and so he could just assuage his fears. Nothing's going on. It's just normal women hanging out together. You know, you can be part of that. You can actually be part of that. But he demurs. He says he has to look after his pollen allergy. But then he's driven out all the time to investigate her.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like he's sneezing all the time either, so I'm not sure.
He's occasionally sneezing, though.
Yeah,
so there is a hay fever there. But then also the one time he does say, okay, I'll go with you. If you want to go, I don't want to act too insane. I'm not going to keep you from seeing your friends. If you want to see your friends, I'll go with you. And then she refuses, which makes it seem very suspicious.
This is happening right after he's barged into an art event and dragged her out in front of everyone. I mean, you think she wants that incident repeated? Of course she doesn't want to go with him.
But any motives we want to ascribe to her are us ascribing them to her, because her face is blank.
Yeah, yeah.
And her voice is blank.
Sylvie Testu, it is an amazing performance.
Now, what she says in her interview, and what she got from this character, she's playing this character, and this is fascinating, as what you see is what you get. Like, when this woman is just, when she says she's not thinking about anything, she's just not thinking about anything. She's just never thinking about anything. She's just in the present, living in the present, every moment, content with what she's doing, who she's with, where she is.
Completely free, she says.
Doesn't have any fantasies, doesn't have any hidden desires, but that's also impossible. That's an impossible person. Which is exactly, you know, what she enjoyed playing about it.
Yeah.
Right? And by the end of the movie, in this conversation they have, so the funniest, I started talking about how funny the movie is, because the funniest sequence is when the way he tries to break up with her. Right?
Yeah, well, he just barges in and she's like, oh, should I come to the room now? And he's like, no, we're breaking up right now. You're leaving right now. We'll never see each other again. Don't try to write to me. Please avoid all areas where we might have in common.
And he also says to her, I have no memory. I'll get over this pretty quickly. But in the meantime, we have to be separate, or I'm not going to get over it.
Except I'm going to drive you all the way to your aunt's place out in the country.
This feels like breakup attempts that I've had. You know, like where you're so deeply into it that you're just like discussing it for hours and hours, but you're still together. You're still doing everything together as you discuss it.
It seems like he means it, but on the other hand,
of course he means it. But
He uses this, and he's okay. Well, we're broken up now. We don't exist anymore. Can you just tell me about all your lies now?
Right, and she comes up with like 2.5.
Yeah, and she explains that these are just keeping a few women's names from you, basically, because I know that they drive you insane.
Yeah.
And he's like, okay, just give me 2 more for my dignity's sake. And she's like, there's nothing else.
No, I mean, he means this, but he's also in the position of a person who doesn't know if they're crazy or not.
Yeah.
Right? And when you don't know if you're crazy or not, you're hedging your bets about what course of action to take. You're doing a thing. You're like, I'm committing to this course of action, but I might be totally insane.
And she tells him throughout this interrogation that she loves him. She doesn't feel the same way about the relationship that he does. She's sorry that he believes it's broken and irreparable.
Yeah.
And when they get to the aunt's place, I mean, she invites him
in. And he keeps saying to her, you're doing this. This is your desire. I know how women like you work. I know that you're mourning for your past lesbian life. And I'm freeing you, and I'm, you know, this is for you. I'm doing this for you. And she's like, no, for you. Only for you. You're doing it for you. You're doing it. I'm not doing it. Over and over.
Yeah. And he finally believes her. And he's like, okay, well, let's try for another few weeks. Let's drive back.
But then he immediately keeps pressing her. We were talking in the last episode, what does the phrase in Leave Her to Heaven mean? Your love pressed father to death. This man is pressing this woman to death. That is what is revealed to us at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
Sylvie Testud's performance keeps on taking more and more gravity, right? As she keeps telling him, stop, leave me alone, don't ask me any more questions. And he can't.
No, and he'll never be able to stop.
What do you make of this ending? Is this a suicide attempt by her?
Well, it certainly seems like it, doesn't it? What's the psychological reasoning behind it? He obviously means a great deal to her.
If it's a suicide attempt, then it turns out that she loved him all along because this... He's pressing her to death.
Yeah, which is what she said. So I think that is how I've interpreted it both times, that this is her confession of love to him. And not only that, because I don't think that's the primary reason. It's also a confession of ultimate despair on her part.
That she can't convince him.
Yeah.
She will never convince him.
What a way for him to learn the truth. And the camera leaves us with him in the prow of this boat by himself, looking like the saddest man on earth.
But I think that we have to, like, I'm not willing to let that ending, again, you know, like the turn of the screw or whatever. I'm not willing to let that ending alter the ambiguity of 2/3 of the movie. Up until that ending, she's Schrodinger's girlfriend.
Up until he decides to break up with her. Because at that point, she starts to say a lot of stuff we haven't heard from her before. But what she says is consistent with a suicide reading of the finale. But you're right, the first 2/3 of the movie, you could be thinking, okay, well, she's got no choice, she's economically dependent on him, or she's distracted and this is a good enough time killer for her. You could have a million different readings of why she's there. But once she starts to tell us why she's there, that it's for him.
Well, what he says, I mean, if we're not going to go, I was thinking, because of the source material, that she's economically dependent or economically getting something out of it. But if we're not going to go with that, what he says is, women like you have been so forced to hide that you're hiding your feelings even from yourself.
Yeah, but she says, no, there are women like that, but that's not me.
Yeah. But that's the beauty of the ambiguity of the movie. So I don't want to interpret her as one thing throughout the movie.
No, that's fair.
I feel like she's a shifting thing. And the only constant about what she is that she's always going to be the wrong thing for him at the wrong time.
And also the exact right thing.
Well, not at the end.
No. Her way of flirting with him is not immediately apparent, but she'll tell him repeatedly, oh, I'm getting tired. Man, this is music to his ears. And she knows that. It's the weirdest sexual relationship of all time, maybe. But, well, no, there are many weirder ones.
Well, that's a real fetish, though. The sleeping woman fetish. Although, normally, more happens than masturbating on her.
Right.
So this is a very special variant on that. So he doesn't even want full sexual contact, I guess. And yes, he doesn't want... You're right. I mean, what's symbolic about this sexual ritual that they have is that he doesn't want responsiveness.
No, he doesn't.
But the lack of responsiveness causes him to have this terrible anxiety that she doesn't want him. So what is this movie about? It is about the paradoxes of this man's desire, the paradoxes of desire, pressing the object of desire to death.
And it's not pure fetishism on his part either, because we see the scene where he's cruising for a prostitute. He tries to get her to pretend to sleep, and it's just no good.
Yeah, it's hilarious, too.
It's got to be Sylvie doing it.
And the woman's like, he says, no, not like that. And the woman says, how? I don't know. But here, go.
Yeah, here's the money.
It's not gonna work.
Easiest 50 bucks she ever made. 50 francs. Well, there's so much going on in the movie. Both central performances are brilliant. Stanislas Mehar, I don't know him from anything else, but he really commits fully to an insane role. And Sylvie Testud, we've also seen her in De Mail de Ménage, another Akerman movie. She's totally different in that one.
But the women singing together.
Of course, there's something there.
Represent this elusive otherness that he needs for his love, but that is driving him insane.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying, right? It's a community he can't be part of.
He can't sustain this tension or this ambiguity of her wanting both. It's almost like bisexual phobia or something. Not being able to accommodate that tension, right? Needing it to be resolved. I mean, among other things. There's so much going on in this movie.
She's a singer, right? I mean, she has artistic, aesthetic ambitions that have nothing to do with their relationship, and he can't deal with that either. And it's all bound up with what he conceives to be her lesbian past or present.
Right, this singing voice is this otherness inside of her that he can't be a part of.
Yeah, exactly. And we get the brief glimpse of the actress from Les Rendezvous d'Anna.
Looking like an absolutely stunning older woman.
Yeah, she's a celebrated opera singer that knows Ariane very well, but Ariane tries to downplay their association. Obviously, Simon can't handle that truth.
So she does lie to him. In Proust, it's partly that there are things to conceal, and also partly because of the lover's jealousy that the woman is, in fact, habitually lying.
Well, I love that scene in the car after he drags her out and he says, well, you know, they're giving awards out tonight to this same woman. You were at this more intimate affair. Obviously, you've been invited to this award ceremony too. And she's like, I hate those kinds of things. I wouldn't go anyway. And he's like, but it's tonight. You would have received an invitation, wouldn't you?
Right. And all of this is just inflaming his paranoia more and more. The fact that she is pretending not to know about all of this.
Yeah. And she looks in her purse and she's like, yeah, well, I got some things this morning. Let me look. Oh yeah, here it is. Here's the invitation. Really bothers him. It's never going to get any better. And you kind of, I mean, I kind of believe what she says when she says that she doesn't like that kind of thing anyway. But that doesn't help him either, because he's like, oh yeah, you'd prefer to be alone with her. You don't want to be sharing her with thousands of adoring fans and awards banquet attendees.
But you see what I mean by the turn of the screw element, right? Because right up until the end of the movie, everything he's saying, although it sounds insane, could be true. Could be what she's hiding behind this facade of blankness.
It could be.
Or, like, after watching this movie, I feel like if anyone could have made the sacred found, Chantal Akerman, there's this one line he had that was particularly sacred foundish. When he says to her something about a woman smiling at her, it's that smile, isn't it? Right? There's a special kind of smile. That's how they signal that they have desire for you. And he means lesbians, right? Yeah. Lesbians have a special smile, like a secret handshake.
And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Exactly, right? I didn't notice any girl or any smile.
No one's smiling by the end of this movie. All right, let's turn our attention to Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We saw Written on the Wind by Douglas Sirk. This is part of a TIFF Cinémathèque series on the romantic melodramas of Yash Chopra and Douglas Sirk. They kick things off in fine style with Written on the Wind, one of Sirk's most studied and most acclaimed films.
And one of his own favorites. He thought this screenplay was very successful. Not only have I seen Written on the Wind a million times, but it was one of those movies that in my early 20s, I had on cassette tape. So I listened to it. This is during a period of singleness in my life. One room efficiency suite, listening to these movies on cassette over and over. So other ones were They Won't Believe Me and Portrait of Jenny.
Those are some rich voices for sure.
And so my experience of watching this movie on the big screen for the first time was of laughing in advance or cringing in advance of the actual lines, because I knew every line just before it was spoken. And there are some of my all-time favorite lines from movies in this movie.
Yeah, you're not sneering at the movie like many of our fellow attendees were.
I felt that it was overall respectful, but there was a giggler sitting next to me that giggled her way through the entire movie.
The people next to me, because, well, we were right next to each other, but I guess on either side, we had some people that, especially the scene where Dorothy Malone goes down to the river and is remembering childhood, I mean, she just couldn't contain herself. She thought it was hilarious. I mean, that's a beautiful, incredible scene.
Well, okay, I have to admit, the one thing I have difficulty with in this movie that's often been on my top 10 favorite movies is the Dorothy Malone performance.
I think she's so good, especially in that scene. And it should be cringeworthy, but I think she invests it with emotion somehow. It's miraculous.
No, I don't feel that way. And it's all the stranger because her performance now looks like the movie's most blatantly camp element. But at the time it was taken seriously, she won an Oscar for it.
Yeah, restored her career.
Whereas the equally insane, but for me, emotionally grounded performance of Robert Stack, see, that's aged fine. But the Dorothy Malone performance, a lot of people have trouble with. And she is a good actress, so she doesn't have to do what she did in this movie. This is clearly what Sirk wanted her to do. But of all the Oscar-winning performances in all of classical Hollywood cinema, this is one that I just cannot deal with it.
Oh, interesting. Well, we're going to have to dig into that. We have this on the schedule for a special subject in 2026, so we don't want to spoil all of our ammunition.
But even with the gigglers, when Stack has that scene where he is on his bender after his father dies, and Lauren Bacall asks him if he loves her, because up until then, that's been the great hope that she can fix him with her love and with his love for her.
He says, I don't even love myself.
I don't even love myself. And crumples in on himself, and my eyes squirted tears. And then he has the whole speech about the avalanche. If he makes a sound or moves at all, the snow avalanche is going to collapse on him.
He's in a bad way.
Like, those are just not emotions that Hollywood movies were going to on a regular basis.
No, that's true.
But the obsessive love is certainly in the Dorothy Malone performance, in keeping with the theme of this episode.
We will delve very deeply into all of the magnificence and perhaps the flaws of Written on the Wind in the Elise's Family Freakouts episode, part 2, coming in 2026. And next week on the podcast, Hollywood Studios Year by Year, RKO 1945. I'm looking forward to this one. We're going to be doing Johnny Angel by Edwin L. Marin and Cornered by Edward Dimitrik.